Penguin Random House Audio presents The Marsh King's Daughter by Karen Dionne. Read for you by Emily Rankin. To be fruitful provokes one's downfall. At the rise of the next generation, the previous one has exceeded its peak. Our descendants become our most dangerous enemies for whom we are unprepared. They will survive and take power from our enfeebled hands. Carl Gustav Jung. From its nest, high on the roof of the Viking's castle, the stork could see a small lake, and by the reeds and the green banks lay the trunk of an alder tree. Upon this, three swans stood flapping their wings and looking about them. One of them threw off her plumage, and the stork recognized her as a princess of Egypt. There she sat, without any covering but her long black hair. The stork heard her tell the two others to take great care of the swan's plumage while she dipped down into the water to pluck the flowers she imagined she saw there. The others nodded and picked up the feather dress and flew away with her swan's plumage. "Dive down now," they cried. "Thou shalt never more fly in the swan's plumage. Thou shalt never again see Egypt. Here, on the moor, thou wilt remain." So saying, they tore the swan's plumage into 1,000 pieces. The feathers drifted about like a snow shower, and then the two deceitful princesses flew away. The princess wept and lamented aloud. Her tears moistened the alder stump, which was really not an alder stump, but the Marsh King himself, he who in marshy ground lives and rules. The stump of the tree turned round and was a tree no more, while long, clammy branches like arms extended from it. The poor child was terribly frightened and started up to run away. She hastened to cross the green, slimy ground, but quickly sank, and the alder stump after her. Great black bubbles rose up out of the slime, and with these, every trace of the princess vanished. Hans Christian Andersen, The Marsh King's Daughter, 1872 translation by Mrs. H. B. Paul. Helena. If I told you my mother's name, you'd recognize it right away. My mother was famous, though she never wanted to be. Hers wasn't the kind of fame anyone would wish for. J.C. Dugard, Amanda Berry, Elizabeth Smart, that kind of thing, though my mother was none of them. You'd recognize my mother's name if I told it to you, and then you'd wonder, briefly, because the years when people cared about my mother are long gone, as she is. Where is she now? And didn't she have a daughter while she was missing? And whatever happened to the little girl? I could tell you that I was 12, and my mother 28 when we were recovered from her captor. That I spent those years living in what the papers describe as a run-down farmhouse surrounded by swamp in the middle of Michigan's Upper Peninsula. That while I did learn to read thanks to a stack of National Geographic magazines from the 1950s and a yellowed edition of the collected poems of Robert Frost, I never went to school, never rode a bicycle, never knew electricity or running water. That the only people I spoke to during those 12 years were my mother and father. That I didn't know we were captives until we were not. I could tell you that my mother passed away 2 years ago, and while the news media covered her death, you probably missed it because she died during a news cycle heavy with more important stories. I can tell you what the papers did not. She never got over the years of captivity. She wasn't a pretty, articulate, outspoken champion of the cause. There were no book deals for my timid, self-effacing wreck of a mother. no cover of time. My mother shrank from attention the way arrowroot leaves wither after a frost. But I won't tell you my mother's name, because this isn't her story. It's mine. 1. Wait here, I tell my 3-year-old. I lean through the truck's open window to fish between her booster seat and the passenger door for the plastic sippy cup of lukewarm orange juice she threw in a fit of frustration. Mommy will be right back. Mary reaches for the cup like Pavlov's puppy. Her bottom lip pokes out and tears overflow. I get it. She's tired. So am I. Mary grunts as I start to walk away. She arches her back and pushes against the seatbelt as if it's a straitjacket. Stay put. I'll be right back. I narrow my eyes and shake my finger so she knows I mean business, and go around to the back of the truck. I wave at the kids stacking boxes on the loading dock by the delivery entrance to Markham's. Jason, I think is his name. Then lower the tailgate to grab the first 2 boxes of my own. Hi, Mrs. Pelletier! Jason returns my wave with twice the enthusiasm I gave him. I lift my hand again, so we're even. I've given up telling him to call me Helena. Bang, 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 from inside the truck. Mary is whacking her juice cup against the window ledge. I'm guessing it's empty. I bang the flat of my hand against the truck bed in response. Bang, bang, bang. And Mary startles and twists around, her baby fine hair whipping across her face like corn silk. I give her my best, cut it out if you know what's good for you, scowl, then heft the cartons to my shoulder. Stephen and I both have brown hair and eyes, as does our 5-year-old, Iris. So he marveled over this rare golden child we created, until I told him my mother was a blonde. That's all he knows. Markham's is the next-to-last delivery of 4, and the primary sales outlet for my jams and jellies, aside from the orders I pick up online. Tourists who shop at Markham's Grocery like the idea that my products are locally made. I'm told a lot of customers purchase several jars to take home as gifts and souvenirs. I tie gingham fabric circles over the lids with butcher's string and color code them according to contents. Red for raspberry jam, purple for elderberry, blue for blueberry, green for cattail blueberry jelly, yellow for dandelion, pink for wild apple choke cherry. You get the idea. I think the covers look silly, but people seem to like them. And if I'm going to get by in an area as economically depressed as the Upper Peninsula, I have to give people what they want. It's not rocket science. There are a lot of wild foods I could use, and a lot of different ways to fix them. But for now, I'm sticking with jams and jellies. Every business needs a focus. My trademark is the cattail line drawing I put on every label. I'm pretty sure I'm the only person who mixes ground cattail root with blueberries to make jelly. I don't add much, just enough to justify including cattail in the name. When I was growing up, young cattail spikes were my favorite vegetable. They still are. Every spring, I toss my waders and a wicker basket in the back of my pickup and head for the marshes south of our place. Stephen and the girls won't touch them, but Stephen doesn't care if I cook them as long as I fix just enough for me. Boil the heads for a few minutes in salted water, and you have one of the finest vegetables around. The texture is a little dry and mealy, so I eat mine with butter now, but of course, butter was nothing I'd tasted when I was a child. Blueberries I pick in the logged-over areas south of our place. Some years the blueberry crop is better than others. Blueberries like a lot of sun. Indians used to set fire to the underbrush to improve the yield. I'll admit, I've been tempted. I'm not the only person out on the plains during blueberry season, so the areas closest to the old logging roads get picked over fairly quickly. But I don't mind going off the beaten path, and I never get lost. Once I was so far out in the middle of nowhere, a Department of Natural Resources helicopter spotted.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.